Hi, I'm Dr. Celine, and in this video, I'm going to show how to code with Java's built-in collections. So these are the four topics I'm going to cover here: how to create collections using those built-in classes and custom classes, how to use the algorithms that are built into the collections to do stuff with your data. I'm going to show how arrays are not actually part of the Java collections and don't work with the collections code. And I'm also going to show how you can't use primitive data types with collections, and instead you have to use wrapper classes. All right, let's get started. So I've created a demo project here called Collection Algorithms, and it's got two classes in it. The collectionAlgorithms.java is the class that I'm going to be mainly using, and this is my demo class. So in my main method, I've started off by creating two different collections here. So the first one is the array list, and this array list that I'm using, I've put this type in here of string. So string is a built-in class in Java. So I'm creating an array list of strings. I'm going to store a whole bunch of strings. I've called this array list names, and this is the code here that creates it. And then these next few lines here add a whole bunch of names to my array list. So array list is a built-in collection in Java, and I'm using it to store a whole bunch of strings. Now I've also below here created a linked list. This is a different type of collection in Java. And later we'll talk about the differences between these two different collections later in this course. But for now, you don't really need to understand the difference. It's just important to note that there are many different types of collections you can use. So here I'm creating a linked list, but this time I'm not storing strings, which is the built-in Java class. I'm storing a class called Avatar. And Avatar is a class that I created. So I can create my own classes, create objects of that classes, and I can store them in these collections. So I've called my linked list of avatars players, and here I've added a whole bunch of new avatars. So before we go on, I just want to open the avatar class so you can see. So here's the avatar class, and this is a fairly simplistic class. Avatar has three different fields: the name for the avatar, their battle power, and their life points. So this is a fairly standard video game type of class. And there's a constructor here, so we can actually create avatars and give it a random name. Or there's a constructor here where we pass in a name. And there's a bunch of getters and setters and things to increase or decrease battle power and life points, etc. Importantly, there's a compare to class here, which allows you to say, how does one avatar compare to another avatar? And in this case, I've decided that avatars should be compared based on their life points. So one avatar is better than another avatar if it has more life points. There's also an equals method. So I'm saying that two avatars are basically the same if they have the same name. Okay, so that's how I'm saying that two different avatars are actually the same thing. And there's this toString method which allows us to print out what the avatar's properties are. And that's pretty much it. This is a fairly simple class. You'll note here that this class implements comparable, and that's how we have this compare to method. And all of the things that we're going to want to store in collections will typically need to have this comparable aspect to them, because we need to be able to order them and things like that. So that's the avatar class. So going back to collections, again, we made a linked list of avatars. We've created a whole bunch of different avatars, all with different names. If you go back, you'll notice that in the constructors of avatar, we're generating initial battle power and life points using random functions. So battle power is going to be some random number between 0 and 9, and life points is going to be a random number between 0 and 999, etc. Okay. The next thing in my demo code is that I'm actually just printing out the collections. So collections can just be printed out. You can just pass them to a systemout.println, and collections will automatically sort of iterate through each item in the collection and call the toString on that item to print it out. So let's just, I've got a whole bunch more code here, but it's all commented out. So let's just run this code and see what happens. And here you can see, I'm going to just make this be down at the bottom of the screen. Here you can see that the first thing that we printed out, which was the names collection, and that was just the array list of these names here, it printed them out. And you can see that in an array list, the things are stored in a certain order and they're printed out in that exact order that they were stored in. And then there's the avatars, and you can see that we've printed out the avatars, and we're printing out for each avatar the name, battle power, and life points. And you can see that they've just sort of been randomly created. The battle power and life points are different for all of these items. So that's just creating two different collections that store different types of objects and printing them out. Now, collections in Java, in the Java Collections framework, collections have algorithms that you can call through static methods. So let's take a look at a couple of these. Here, we are going to get the min in our collections. So we are creating a string called min name, and we're calling collections.min. This is a function that we can call on any collection, and we just pass in the collection. Now here we're passing in names, which is our array list of strings, and it's going to send us out the min, or the smallest name, and we have to capture it here in this return value, which is why this is a string, because name stores strings. Now, what's the smallest names? Well, names are strings, so this is going to give us the lowest alphabetical name. And then down here, and we're going to print that out here. And then down here, we're going to capture an avatar, min av, and we're going to call collections.min. And this time, we're going to pass it this collection of players. So note that we're calling the same function, collections.min, collections.min, but we're passing two totally different things. Here, we're passing an array list of names, and here we're passing a linked list of players. So collections, static methods like min, run these algorithms on any type of collections, which makes it pretty powerful. So min is going to give us the smallest player. And again, you might say, well, what's the smallest player? And because we wrote that compare to method in avatar, the smallest player is going to be the player with the smallest number of life points. So now that we've uncommented this code, let's run the code and see what happens. So again, the code has, the collections have been printed here. And now for min, this says the min name is Abby. And if we look across these names, we see that in fact, Abby is the smallest in terms of alphabetical order. It comes first. It says the min player is avatar, the name is Byron, the battle power is 8, the life points is 71. And if we look through this list of avatars, we can see that there's a whole bunch with different life points. But in fact, it looks like, yeah, the avatar Byron has the lowest number of life points. Okay, so that was printing out min. Here's another version, and this is max, and so this is very similar. And you can kind of guess what this one will do. We are calling collections.max, again with the array list of names, and we're calling collection.max with the linked list of players. So now we'll run this. Now, note that the values here are going to change, because every time we run this, we're going to generate new lists here, and the avatars in particular are going to have different life points each time we run it. So this time the min name is still Abby, the min player is an avatar named Steven with life points of 150. The max name is Tanvi, and again, if we look at this list of names, T is comes last alphabetically. And the max player is an avatar named Mustafa with life points of 971. So again, you're seeing that these algorithms you can run on collections are really general. You can pass kind of any collection of stuff in and it will do the right thing. All right, let's see some more algorithms. Sorting, a really important topic in data structures and algorithms. So here we are asking Java to sort our two different lists. So here's collection.sortNames, and we're going to print it out after sorting. And here's collection.sortPlayers, and we're going to print that out after playing. So let's run this now and see what happens. So again, you can see the original printing. Here's the list of names, and here's the list of avatars. And now, after sorting, you can see that the list of names is Abby, Ahmed, Byron, Celine, Kareem, Mustafa, Sophie, Stephen, Tanvi. So that's in alphabetical order. It did that for us. And here's the list of avatars, and of course avatars are going to be listed in order of life points. So Ahmed comes first with life points of 2, and you can see the life points just keep going up as we scroll along here until we get to the end. And in this case, Celine is the last avatar listed with life points of 950. Okay, so that's sorting two different types of collections with different types of objects. Now here's something we can do where we're going to check the frequency of something in the list. Okay, so here we're going to check the frequency of an item. We're going to find out how many times the name Celine shows up in the names list. And we're going to find out how many times there's a player with the name of Tanvi in the players list. So we'll run this. And we'll see that number of Celine in the names list is 1, number of Tanvi in players list is 1. So that is also correct. So this tells us how many times something shows up in our collection. All right, next we're going to reverse our collections. And so here, this is just basically similar to sorting, except that we're going to have it sort go in reverse order. So we'll run this. And now if we scroll down, we can see that our names are now in reverse alphabetical order, and the avatars are now in reverse order of the life points. Okay. One more thing that we're going to do with the built-in algorithms that you can run on collections, we're going to shuffle our collections. So here, this code calls collections.shuffle. Again, we're passing in the names array list, and this code calls collections.shuffle, and we're passing in the players linked list. So we'll run that, and we'll have a look down here, and now we can see that this list of names is all just randomly shuffled, and the list of avatars is randomly shuffled with battle points or life points going up and down as we look across. Okay, so this gives you the sense that collections within Java, the built-in collections, you can create different types of collections. Each collection can hold any type of object you want, and you can run these built-in algorithms that are methods on collections and have things done to your collection. So collections are pretty powerful. Some of the things that you can't do with collections are also important to understand as you continue with your programming. So one of the most important things to know is that the array, which is probably the first data structure that you ever learned when you started learning programming, is not an official collection in Java. An array was part of the very first Java version that was ever created. It's a basic data structure. Collections were added a little bit later. And so array is kind of special. It's not in the collections framework and it doesn't behave as a collection. So let's look at what happens if we start using arrays. So if I create an array here, so this line 108, I've created a string array. It's called test and it's got 4 names in it. So this is a perfect array because I'm just initializing it with 4 items in it and it's going to have 4 slots and that's all. So I've got an array called test. It's got these 4 names in it. Can I call my collections method with it? If I uncomment these 3 lines of code, you will note that they are all going to give errors. Collections.sort and I pass in this array and the error that I'm getting is this, well, very ugly verbose error from Java. No suitable method found for sort string array. So you may get an error like this and not really understand. This one says incompatible types, string cannot be converted to list. And this one says no suitable method found for min string array. So you can't pass arrays into these collections methods. These collections methods only work with things that are part of the collections framework, things that have implemented the collections interface. An array just doesn't work. So we're going to comment that out. And that may leave you feeling like, well, arrays are just useless. I never want to use them again. Arrays can still be useful. And there are some similar types of methods built in, but you have to call the arrays method. So here I've called arrays.sort. And this will allow me to sort and I can pass in test. And note that this isn't causing any compile errors. I'm going to be fine with this. And then I can iterate across this array and print out the different arrays. So let's run that and see what happens. So here we can see that by passing that array into arrays.sort, it has actually sorted this array into alphabetical order and we're printing it up here. So you just have to remember that you can't use arrays with the collections methods. Okay, the last thing that we really need to talk about is this idea of collections only working with objects. So we're going to spend a lot of time talking about collections and generics. And generics are a placeholder for an object or a class. But I have this line of code here, ArrayList int myNums new ArrayList. If I uncomment this, you will see that I'm getting an error. So this doesn't look all that different from how I created this ArrayList up here, right? ArrayList string names new ArrayList string. But down here, I'm passing in int, and this just doesn't work. You can't use primitive types with collections. And so if we hover over this error, it will say unexpected type. It requires a reference and it found an integer. So what it's looking for is a pointer to some type of object. It's looking for a class so it knows that what you're going to store in this collection is some objects. And int as a primitive data type just doesn't work. Similarly, down here, a linked list of the char type. Again, this doesn't work. Unexpected type. It was looking for a reference and it found a char. So we can't do this. And you may say, well, that's crazy. That makes collections not very powerful because ints are good and chars are good and sometimes I need those things. But don't despair. There's a way around this. What you basically do is you use the wrapper classes. So here we have, I'm going to uncomment this code. We have examples of how you do this. So here we've created an array list of integers. So note capital I and integer fully spelled out. So this is basically very similar to this line up here. It's just we've replaced the small I int with the capital I integer, and capital I integer is just a class that can hold ints, but it's going to be an object. So things are going to have references and objects in the same way that strings and other objects do. Okay. And similarly, we've created linked list character, capital C, character fully spelled out. And here we can store chars. So with these, you may think, okay, well now do I have to, every time I want to use an integer, have to create like an integer object and all that? It sounds really complicated, but Java actually does all of that for you automatically. So you can see we created an array list of integer objects. It's called myNums, and right here, all we have to do is say mynums.add27. It's simple. It's as simple as that. And Java will take this 27, it will put it into an integer object and pass it into that ArrayList collection. So this is very much the same as saying mynums.add, and you could do the whole object creation thing. You could say new integer and pass in a number. But actually, you can see that we're getting a little warning here. It's saying unnecessary boxing to integer. This is saying you don't need to do this. Java will do it for you. Like, don't worry about trying to do that. Okay. And similarly here with the linked list of characters, we've got mychars.add, and I've just put in the char B. You could also do mychars.add and say create a new character object and pass in M. But again, you don't need to do that because Java will do it for you automatically. So we can run this and you'll see that it runs just fine. I don't actually have anything printing out for these lists that have these wrapper objects, but they would print out just fine. So hopefully that gives you a sense of what collections are like in Java. There's a whole bunch of them. You can create them and add stuff to them, and there's all sorts of things you can do. You can remove stuff and so on. And then there are these algorithms that you can run by passing the whole collection in, and it'll sort them and shuffle them and do all sorts of interesting things. You have to remember that you can't use arrays. You can't pass in arrays as collections. Arrays are different. And you have to remember that you can't create collections with primitive data structures, so you need to use the wrapper classes for your data structures, such as int, char, float, etc. All right, I hope that gives you a good sense of collections in Java, and we'll talk more about this later in the class.